So today, our speaker is Dr. Cunningham, Dr. Glenn Cunningham. He is the Associate Provost of the United States Army War College, and his topic is privacy in the digital age. So please welcome Dr. Cunningham.
Well, thank you very much. I want to start off just by saying this is quite a surprise. I was expecting a rather small group of maybe an intimate seminar of six people. Wasn't expecting to fill a room with people that all look smarter than I am. So we'll see how this goes. I got into cyber ethics in a backward way. It wasn't anything I started with or developed professionally. My area of study and expertise is in organizational design and strategic level leadership. I've done research in largely in terms of systems organizations, systems management, and the use of intuition by senior leaders, which is, to me, a very exciting topic. Everyone likes to think that decisions are made on a very rational basis, but usually they're not made on a rational basis at all. People go with the first thing that pops into their mind. And in the case of many strategic leaders, that's a better option. But that's a topic for a different day. Cyber ethics, then, for me, was an evolution of basic understanding of ethics, and then applying it in terms of the civil, what we now find in the 21st century. In terms of privacy in the digital age, that's really not a very complicated process. I can explain it very simply. You have none. And that's where it works out. So what I want to do is, rather than focus on specific privacy in the digital age, we'll get to that. I'm sure you've all read the required reading. You know, every class has to do that. And so you understand the basic presentation that O'Connor and Lang made. So we're going to see how that fits into the concept and the structure of ethos in general, and try and understand what's different about cyber ethics in the 21st century that differs from ethics that we've dealt with in the past. And so I want you to think about these kind of things. I want you to interrupt whenever you feel like interrupting. And I want you to, again, use your brain, just like Rodney's thinker there. You're probably familiar from that from Gobi Dillis back in the 1950s. Oops. Okay, I don't know what I did, but okay, somebody did something. Okay, so again, what we're going to do is talk about ethical reasoning in cyberspace and how it applies. Okay, why bother? That's always the first question I answer whenever time somebody lectures to me. Why should we worry about this kind of thing? First of all, we need to worry about it because ethics is important to leaders. You know, it makes a difference, and leadership matters in organizational success. That's why leaders exist. They don't exist independently. They exist in a combination with followers and with the mission and the task that the organization has to perform. If there's nothing to be done, there's no requirement for leadership. But leadership does matter, and ethics is important to leaders. So it's important to realize, though, that one of the things that makes leaders important is that they set the ethical tone for their organizations. If you have a corrupt guy at the top, you're going to have corruption throughout the organization. It just permeates. It drips down. It's trickle-down evilness, if you will. Conversely, an ethical leader tends to have an ethical organization. And so ethics matters in organizational success. It should be no surprise to anyone, for example, that Enron collapsed in a terrible, terrible scandal, which hurt many people in this nation and elsewhere with the investment policies. Because if you go back and read the statement of ethical principles that Ken Lay himself signed, ethics for Enron meant not disclosing what the company was doing. That's their ethics. Had nothing to do with being fair, being just, being equitable, being upright in your business practices. It was, don't convey a company secret outside the company. And that was their ethical statement of principles. Make sure I push the right button here. So here's what we're going to try and do. You have to have a statement of objectives. It's part of every class. Okay, now we've had it, we can move on. Here's what we're going to try and do. We're going to try and examine some of these issues and deal with them in terms of the commonalities of ethical practice. We're also going to try and enable you to consider your own ethical perspectives with regard to the internet, which hasn't been around for all that long. And then we're going to develop, I hope, a simple framework for trying to put this together in cyberspace. How do these ethical principles apply in cyberspace? And finally, I just want to have an opportunity for you to think about it, ask questions, and reflect upon this major and important factor. Here's what we're not going to do. I'm not going to give you a list of legalistic do's and don'ts. You have to figure that out on your own. And I'm not going to try and replace your particular ethical or religious beliefs with something outside of that framework, something you don't have available to you. You can make these decisions based on your own backgrounds. And we're certainly not going to substitute some elitist theoretical philosophical jibber-jabber for your own common sense, because that's not what ethics is all about. You know, we're not going to talk about deontology versus consequentialism. Okay, that's not the intent here, because quite frankly, none of that really matters. What matters is right and wrong. So here's the big picture. We're trying to focus on values, practices, decision-making patterns. I want you to think interdisciplinarily, think across the board. How does ethics in general apply to ethics in cyberspace? And in addition to that, we're going to see how things work out specifically in the digital age. We're going to talk about old dead guys, at least a little. Some of us are closer to that than we'd like to think. We're going to talk about ethical principles and how they apply in the digital age and try and distinguish between legal and moral imperatives, because I think that's important, particularly when you're talking about ethics. The one person you never want to talk to about ethics is a lawyer. And we're going to try, again, to focus and put some emphasis specifically on privacy in the digital age. Okay. Now, does everyone have, a reasonable idea where we're headed? Everybody shake your heads like this. Okay, good. We're in good shape. Okay, this is where we're headed. We're going to figure out what we do with this notion of digital self and what it means to us in this century. Okay, cyberspace, what are we talking about here? So, what is cyberspace? What brave person out there can offer a potential definition? You can throw something out. We'll beat it to death until we come up with a right answer. What is cyberspace? Is it new? Yeah, as a matter of fact, that's really about when it started. But it really developed a lot earlier than that. Remember somebody by the name of Samuel Morse and telegraph keys? That's where digitalness starts. Dots and dashes in Morse code aren't a whole lot different than the zeros and ones that make up binary code. The dots and dashes are really a form of binary code. And so what we're talking about cyberspace really starts with that. It's the use of the electromagnetic spectrum to convey information. And it goes into the latter part or beginning part of the 19th century with Morse code. In the latter part of the 19th century, Alexander Graham Bell, using Chinese investment money, by the way, developed the telephone. That's a step forward. We have Marconi and the radio, another step forward. And finally, we have radar. We have a whole lot of things being developed, particularly as an ancillary to World War II, that propelled us into the digital age as we know it now, starting in about the 50s. So what is ethics? How do we apply ethics to cyberspace? It's a way of behaving. In particular, I think, it's not just a way of behaving, it's an examination of the way we ought to behave, the way we want to live our lives. We'll talk more about that later on. And just what's integrity? This is a tough one, but break down the word to its root causes. Inta, what does inta mean? As an integral, integer. Pretty good. What do you mean by integrate?
Do what you say and say what you mean, so that you are integrated.
Yeah.
You don't
say exactly. What's an integer? One. And when we talk about integrity, that's sometimes, to me, the best way of looking at it. Is everything one? Is your thinking, your speech, and your actions the same? Or are they different? Do you say one thing and do another? Do you think one thing and say another? Is there an element of discontinuity in the way you approach things? And that's integrity. And so that's what we need to worry about in terms of ethics in cyberspace. How can we develop a single vision of this that does us well? Now, ethics in the Western tradition, at least, is often called moral philosophy. But the term comes from ethikos, which is a Greek word. Oh, those Greeks, they were very busy back then. They were very busy thinking about deep thoughts because they had lots of slave labor doing all the work. So it enabled them to come up with these great moral philosophies. But ethikos means the theory of life. Now, what does that tell us about how the ancient Greeks viewed ethics? If you define it as the theory of life. It's okay, we'll be here all afternoon. That's right. It was central to what they were thinking about. Life was thinking. And an unexamined life was not worth living. So, this idea of studying ethics for them means I'm a human being. I'm different from the brutes and the beasts. I can think, I can act, so how should I live my life? And that's ethics. So it means thinking about what's right or wrong, what's good or bad, about the things that you and I do every day. It's not something for some philosopher in an ivory tower. Do they have any ivory towers at the U.S. Army War College? I have never looked. Maybe there's some. There's some intellectual ones, that's for sure. But it's not about that. It's about the decisions that you and I make every single day about what's good and bad, right or wrong. Or, in some cases, better and worse. Problem is, it's not easy. Most of us don't get a chance to make decisions about what's good or bad. That would be pretty simple. It's either good or it's good or bad. But we get to make decisions about what's the better good? Or what's the lesser of these two evils? Therein lies our problem. So these are ethical questions. And I'm just throwing these up, so when it does come to the time for the Q&As in the latter part of this session, you have an idea of what kind of questions you might want to think about and ask. Has everybody had a chance to look at them? Okay, I'm not going to ask you to answer these. If I did, I'd put them in blue. Ah, looks like blue questions. You're in trouble now. Okay. There are different branches of ethics. Now, meta-ethics really is the study. Meta means big or combined. And all we're talking about here is the study of development of ethical concepts and what that means. So a meta-ethical question would be, what do we mean when we say something is right? Mm-hmm. It certainly should be. Our belief system? What about on high? It starts to get complicated pretty quickly. Now, normative ethics is different. It's the study of guiding human conduct. And a norm is a standard of behavior. The kind of a question that a normative ethicist would ask, well, what should we do to be right? What should we do to be right in the things that we're doing? So it's different than meta-ethics. We're not talking about concepts. We're talking about, again, it's getting closer to us, the things that you and I do and decide every single day. Then there's applied ethics, and this is a tough one because there's so many different ways to apply it. Bioethics. Who has a right to your DNA? This is a big question, because there are DNA deposits out there, and some of it might even be yours. Who has access to that information? In terms of cyber ethics, who is it right to accumulate big data in order to protect national security? Everybody's thought that. Every single American, I think, thought that that was proper on the 12th of September, 2001. Some of us are having buyer's remorse. Okay, particularly when it is without the consent or even the knowledge of the individuals involved. Now, a bit of anthropology here so we understand what we're talking about. Norms are standards of behavior which are just accepted in a culture or a society. They tend to differ, but they tend to differ in form sometimes more than substance. And the thing that makes norms particularly powerful is that they're always connected with sanctions. That is, if you don't obey a norm, you get punished for it. If you do obey a norm, you get rewarded for it. It's very Pavlovian. And these help everybody enforce the norms. In some cases, this is the basis of society, how you enforce cultural norms. And Confucianism is kind of inundated with this. But norms come in three varieties. Let me see if I can make this work. You got folkways, and they're mild norms, mores, and laws. Now, folkways are mild norms. What would an example of a folkway be? Right, driving on the right side of the road, left side of the road. You had something else.
Manners,
etiquette. You know, you're not supposed to, at the buffet line, take your plate back the second time. You're supposed to get a new plate. That's a folk way. You know, opening the door for somebody else when you know their hands are full. That's a folk way. And what happens about the sanctions? What are the sanctions for folkways?
Ostracism,
but they're minimal. If you violate a folkway, you're considered eccentric, but you're not considered a reprehensible criminal. You know, you're allowed to eat peas with your spoon without becoming a social outcast. At least I hope so. I always eat mine. Now, mores are different. Mores come and they attach themselves to the very basic and foundational beliefs of a culture. So when we're talking mores, we're talking serious business. We're also talking serious sanctions. What would an example of a more be in American culture? Think of something you really consider reprehensible. Murder. Pardon?
We have laws about that.
We do. But you know, even if we didn't have laws about murder, that wouldn't make it would be right to do in your neighbor. But that's something very foundational. That's at the core of what we're doing. about stealing children and selling them to gypsies. My mother always threatened to sell me to gypsies every time I misbehaved. But is that something that we countenance in our culture? No, you're supposed to nurture our children, not abuse them. And certainly not in that way. So mores generally have very, very serious sanctions opposed to them. When you violate a more, sometimes you're talking a life or death situation and a life or death sanction. Now, laws are just written down norms. They can be either serious or not. For example, if you park your car in the wrong spot at the Army Heritage and Education Center, you violated a norm of our culture. So you're supposed to go in the little areas that are marked off in white lines. So if you violate that, what's your punishment? A ticket. Okay? So we either weasel our way out of the ticket, or we pay the 15 bucks or whatever it takes to get out of the fine, and we go on our merry way. On the other hand, if your neighbor's dog starts barking, and you come to AHEC and get a World War I issue trench mace and beat the dog to death in front of the children of the neighbor, what are your sanctions going to be? Arrest, incarceration, fines, very serious. But again, laws are just written down norms. And so there's nothing magical in ethics about laws. They're just written down, and they change. At one time, it was legal to own slaves. Is it right to own slaves? No, everybody says no. We didn't say that back in 1830. So laws can change, but again, they're based on folk ways and mores. But this isn't new stuff. I'm not making this stuff up, really. Other people have worried about this. Okay, here's the basic Cro-Magnon creed of our ancestors. And this was very, very effective, 10,000 years ago. I made this up for an ethicist friend of mine. He works now for the University of North Carolina. He said, what's a basic ethical creed? So I said, I got one that's very basic, and this is what I came up with. You know? And for millennia, this worked out pretty well, but it doesn't anymore. Okay. So even in antiquity, people started to come up with ethics and come up with rules, come up with trying to study this out, what is right for us to do. How should we live our lives? And you can see there are a number of people, starting with good old Tahotep. He wrote the admonitions in the 23rd century BC. It's a long time ago. Yeah. Hammurabi and his laws, we're always familiar with that. Moses and the Torah, which is the foundation of many Western legal systems. And who mentioned murder earlier as being amore? Thou shalt not kill. This stuff is foundational. Homer in the Iliad and the Odyssey, how people interact with each other. He's really describing the culture of his time. And Kung Fu, the five classics in China. If we had time, we'd go into Chinese ethics and Chinese way of rule, and you might come to a feeling, perhaps at the end of it, that the only difference between Confucianism and communism in China is that the end of the word differs from the beginning C. Because the application of it, the way they approach it, the way they apply it in their society is pretty much the same. And of course, Kautilya and the Arthashastra, which is, compared to Kautilya, Machiavelli's a child's bedtime story. Okay, but this is what's key here. Ethics is defined by a central authoritarian power backed by religious sanction And it's just assumed as a given. Okay, you obey the laws, the rules, because we're supposed to. And the centralized authority, usually an organized priesthood, will help enforce those rules. Then we enter the classical period. And you're familiar with these names, I hope. Everybody familiar with these names? They shouldn't be a surprise to anybody. And they're great philosophers, and they're important. Now, Socrates is the first. Okay, and he's the first one really came up with thinking that people possess certain virtues, and if those virtues were what separates us from lower life forms, that's the kind of thing we should be studying. We should be studying a life that's in search of the truth so that we can find out how to be better human beings. Now, Socrates was a great guy. There's a bust of Socrates, but he had a student. Who was his student? Plato. Plato admires Socrates a great deal, but he thought that people were essentially rational, and they could, in fact, if they followed Socrates' admonition and spend a life in search of truth, rationally come up with that truth. And so what's key about him is that he truly believes that education is important. We have to talk about these kinds of things. We have to educate our youth to understand ethics as the theory of life, how to live your life. And he had also had a student who was Plato's student. Yes, Aristotle. Aristotle is important because he said it's not enough to talk about being good or simply study what virtues are. It's essential to do good things. We got to put that into a life that's practical. Aristotle's the kind of person where if you asked him in a very nice, sophist kind of way, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to hear it, does it make a noise? Aristotle's response would be something to the effect of course it does. Now, quit asking stupid questions and worry about something important. So he wants virtuous deeds. He wants action. He wants things to be done. The important thing is doing it. It's putting it into your life. It goes back to what you said, ma'am, about integrity at the very beginning. You know, your actions have to match your words, have to match your thoughts. It's got to be one complete whole. Now, Aristotle had a student. Alexander the Great. And there's the epitome of somebody who likes to do things. So you can see that this is a good program that they've developed in ancient Greece. But things changed right about 0 BC. Something happened that was different. I call it the Eastern Imposition. Okay. And it starts with the teaching of Jesus of Nazareth, who says, you know, I see what everybody's doing, and you're all very good at adhering to the letter of the law, but nobody's really serious about it. And he postulates for the first time that intentions matter, consequences matter. It's not just the act itself, it's the motives and what goes beyond the act. You're all familiar with the teaching on adultery. When he says very clearly, you know, adultery is forbidden. It's one of Moses' laws. He says, but that's not where you need to worry about. Okay? He who looks after a woman to lust after her has already committed adultery in his heart. That's new. People don't understand that. He comes up with the golden rule, of course. And this is common in just about every culture, but it's basically, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This is pretty sound guidance under most circumstances. And interestingly, he sets the example for Harvard University and the Kennedy School of Government because he institutes a program of case studies. They're called parables. And they seem to work out pretty well for him. He has two disciples that are very important, Simon Peter and Paul of Tarsus. And what they start to do is talk outside Eastern culture, outside Judea, They start talking to Greeks. They start talking to Romans. And then they run into certain problems because the Greeks and the Romans and the Persians do not think the way that the Jews of that time did. So they've got to justify and blend this Eastern religion with Western philosophy. And really, that occupies most of the Middle Ages.
What are you calling Eastern thinking there?
I'm calling something from Asia Minor. I'm talking what we now call the Judean Christian culture, because it is established really in the East. It's not a Western idea. The Greeks are a Western idea. The Jews are fairly Eastern, Semitic. That's what I'm calling it. So then we run into medieval Christianity, and these guys all have the same goal in mind. And they go through it through centuries, from the 4th century AD up to the 1313. What they're trying to do is a very, very difficult thing, because they've got to move out on the tradition of Paul and Peter and reconcile ethics in an authoritarian world. This is a world ruled by dukes, ruled by kings, ruled by emperors, who could chop off your head in a heartbeat if they just felt like it. Absolute authority to do that. So they're in an authoritarian world, but they're using secular Greek methodologies and the way the Greeks thought and their patterns of logic in order to explain and defend a Christian reliance on God. I would postulate to you that that's not easy. That's a tough thing. And it takes some centuries to work on it, and I'm not sure they ever really succeeded that well. And then you come into the Renaissance and later. Okay? Machiavelli, and what Machiavelli postulates, and Machiavelli's really a good thinker. It goes way beyond the notion that the end justifies the means. What he says is that ethics at the individual level may not necessarily apply at the strategic level, and that really, to do the right thing, sometimes the boss has to do the big dirty. And it's true. Hobbes, he comes up as ethics as a social contract. That is, you know, people want to do things together. They have practical goals. And what they do is they develop a social context or a social contract on how to act that enables individuals and society to mutually progress and accomplish their goals. We're all familiar with Hume, Bentham, and John Stuart Mill. Bentham's interesting. You know, when he died, he had his whole body, to include his head, preserved. I mean, kind of a little display case. You can go see it if you go to England. Of course, the head's off, fell off, and you know, you can put it on the ground next to him if you want to. But that's kind of interesting. And what they postulate is morality is not really a matter of pleasing God. You can go that far if you want to, but what it really is, it's not about virtuous rules. It's about bringing the greatest good to the greatest number. Greatest good to the greatest number. Okay. A very persuasive way of looking at things. It's not necessarily very persuasive if you're not the greatest number. If you're a minority, sometimes things differ. And then Immanuel Kant took that a little step further, and he's very important because he enters the notion that we should respect people. Individuals have dignity. And we have to do things that respect their dignity. And he devised the categorical imperative. And that is really, he defines that two ways in two different books. One is, act only according to that maxim by which you can, at the same time, will, that is, want it to become a universal law that applies to everybody, categorically. And another way he put that was, you should never use people as a means to an end. People are people. They are not tools. Hang on to that thought in cyber ethics. Okay, here's the current state of play. There's a whole bunch of different philosophical theories. You know, they all evolve around good. You know, for example, Personal subjectivism. What's good for me is good. Okay. There's cultural relativism. That is, what's good for us is good. There's the divine command theory. What's good for God is good. I certainly hope so. And natural law theory. What's good for the universe is good. You know, there's a natural way of doing things that's good. Psychological egotism is what's good for me is good for all of us. Okay? And that's not as bad as ethical egoism, which is sort of, you know, what's good for me is good and the devil take the hindmost. You know, this is sort of Ayn Randish. You know, it's taking it one step further. Okay? Unitarianism, we talked about that with Bentham and Hume. What's best for the greatest happiness of the greatest number is good. And of course, then we have moral absolutism. What's good for one is one for all. Or what's good for one is also good for all. You know. And Kant's categorical imperative pushes in that direction. Hedonism, feels good, do it. Very popular. And social contract ethics, what's good for all is good for one. John Rawls takes this a step further in the 21st century and talks in terms of social justice. That social justice is important not just for minorities, but for majorities. And the one absolute law, then, or absolute rule that you can't violate, is you have to enable a minority to become a majority. And that's key. Ethics of virtue, good deeds are good, and the ethics of caring. There's more to goodness than hard logic, and relationship matters. You're familiar, of course, with the story of the man on the bridge. It's the mighty Susquehanna River, and it's flood time. Down the mighty Susquehanna, as he stands on the bridge, it's probably the one on 83 that goes across. He sees two people floating down the river. One is an old man. He looks harder. It's his father, 87 years old. Just a few years left in his life. Been a working man all his life. Not educated. Not a high school graduate. Wasn't necessary back then in 1929 when he was in high school to graduate. He's an old man. His family's raised, gone. All he does now is collect Social Security, take care of his little dog. And then you see another guy floating down the river. Young man, you look harder, and you just heard him on National Public Radio, WITF. He's a neurosurgeon, highly respected in his field, a prodigy. He started out young and just got better. He's got a young wife, two small children. He's got the potential for decades to come to make a contribution to society through the skill of his education, his experience, and the talent of his hands. You've got one rope and can make one throw. Who do you throw it to? I don't know about you, but I'm throwing it to my dad. The neurosurgeon can swim on his own. Now, relationships matter. Okay, but this is 2015. So what do we got to do? Okay, realize that ethics has been thought about for a long time. It doesn't matter that they're... have ever been easy answers to ethical questions. Doesn't seem we're getting much closer. Cyber ethics is new, still not easy. That doesn't make it less important for you and I. We're still stuck making decisions, still stuck trying to come up with the answers. But, and here's the good news. If all Tahoe could come up with answers that work for him, we can do the same thing. That's what we have to do. You don't need to be an ethicist to be ethical. Ethics is our business. Every day, you and I are faced with decisions about right and wrong, good and bad, better or best. We've got to make them. It's part of what it means to be a human being. And that's where it lies. Now, everybody familiar with the famous sculptor Rodney and his another thing? Some people are shaking their heads. Is there a mistake someplace? Pardon? Oh, is it? Yeah. Rodin. Well, what do you know? Okay. That's the first thing about making ethical choices. Make sure you have your facts straight. Okay. Now we'll talk a little bit about cyber ethics. And here's a framework for thinking about cyber ethics, which I hope you find useful. And this is Lessig's focus. And he says that we all have a basic ethical code. It can be anything from subjective relativism all the way down to utilitarianism. But we have a basic ethical code. But we have to filter that through four different lenses that are available to us. One of those is the law. We can make policy. We can make regulations. We can get Congress to act on things. Foolish me. But it is possible. It's theoretically possible. Another is code. And by code, I don't mean the same thing as laws. I mean the stuff that makes programs work, the writing down of the apps, the software. That's the code. We can manipulate the code in a way that works out to an ethical advantage. Norms. We have norms of behavior that we can just expect people to adhere to. And we've got market values, because a lot of cyberspace is measured in dollars and cents. Ultimately, the ruler for everything is the dollar. And so market forces and market values can also drive cyberspace activities. And those are the four lenses that we can apply our ethical code through. Now, what's the problem with that? Looks very nice. Little straight lines, nice even circles. Pardon? Yeah, they don't always go back and forth. It's hard to say which one applies. It's hard to say how does it apply. That's where judgment comes in. So it's not easy just to make a nice little diagram and go left, right, left, right, left, right, and get where you're supposed to go. It doesn't flow that way. It's far more complicated. Yes, very difficult to apply sanctions.
It's difficult to take into account how others respond to requiring you to respond.
Right, and sometimes it's difficult to how do you apply sanctions against somebody you can't find? Okay, here's the internet. This is just a quick history. It started in the late 50s and 60s, and these were experimental things at the post-World War II age. You know, it's the age of airplanes. It's the age of radar. It's the age of radio. It's the age of sonar. Things are coming of age, things that we recognize. In the War College, when we talk about campaign analysis, we started in World War II because those things are what made World War II different qualitatively from previous conflicts. Airplanes, radar, radios. That makes a difference. It's really cyber warfare. Okay. In 1971, DOD started the Advanced Research Projects Agency Network to allow all these whiz kids who were developing all this neat new stuff a way to communicate with each other. And pretty soon it became very popular. In fact, they used it to send messages back and forth to each other, which is the first use of email. It became so popular, they decided it got too thick. They needed things in that, because you could only really send about 15 of these a day off of any particular net. So they developed something called MILNET to focus on military issues. The National Science Foundation had NSFNet, and these nets begin to proliferate. And so in 1974, the term internet is first used to say how these different nets can all integrate with all each other. Then, of course, in 1989, Berners-Lee proposes a structure for the World Wide Web. He says you can actually put documents out there in something called HLMT files that anybody can access. And you can send them back and forth. And that's very important. 1990s, this starts to take off. In fact, we have a browser war in the 1990s between Microsoft's Internet Explorer and Netscape. Remember that? So, because people are using those browsers to surf the web, as it was called. By 1993, it becomes commercialized. And in fact, commercial vendors, MCI and CompuServe, did anybody remember CompuServe? Who here had a CompuServe account back then? A lot of people. It was a subscription, wasn't it? You paid monthly access or so. Well, they seize about a third of the market. So a third of the traffic now is MCI and CompuServe. 1995, eBay becomes established, and so does Amazon.com. And e-commerce takes off, and people go ka-chink, like a little cash register. Their little eyes are like the cartoon. They turn into dollar signs. And they think, we can turn this into cash-producing stuff and do so. Of course, 2000, reality strikes in. We had the dot-com bust. But e-commerce rebounded, really did. 2004, MySpace.com comes up. And MySpace.com allows you to make your own little website. You don't need anybody fancy to do it. You can make a pretty good one just using the MySpace technology, their code. Facebook comes up and says, I'll tell you what, I'll set it up, and you just plug your stuff into my website, and everybody's will be the same, but it's a lot easier. And Facebook comes out in 2005. By 2013, we have 2.2 billion users. That's about a third of the world using the internet, and e-commerce breaks $1 trillion U.S. dollars. So it's really taken off. It's got social benefits. We're globally connected now. We can exchange information in microseconds. If you have a question, all you need to do is Google Wikipedia, and you'll get more or less a good answer. I say that one time because I was checking on Wikipedia for another course I give on the Boxer Rebellion and discovered that somebody had gone in there, probably Chinese, and the Chinese had won. So that was pretty good. Okay. Freedom of speech is perverted. You got sites out there dedicated to how you are, all of you, I can see it in your eyes, and probably some of you fall into this category. Some of you are manipulated by reptilian aliens from Arcturus. And some of you are reptilian aliens from Arcturus. If I look hard in your eyes, I'm supposed to be able to tell. At least that's what some of these websites say. You got absolute hate being generated. You have the use of the internet to recruit young Muslims into radicalism. Free speech has become perverted. Intellectual property on the internet? You got to be kidding me. If it's out there, it's good. It's mine. All I got to do is cut and paste. Spam is proliferating. We're all familiar with that, as well as outright fraud. How many of you received an email in the recent past about a prince in Nigeria who has $20 million and is looking for somebody he can trust, and he found your name purely arbitrarily someplace and knows you're the guy or gal? We've all got that. Why don't they stop? Because somebody is falling for those. It doesn't have to be you, but somebody is. Cybercrime. It's no longer a question of fraud. It's outright theft. People are deliberately going into Target and deliberately downloading all your credit card information. They're chopping it up into little chunks and selling the information to other people. And then have you ever noticed sometimes on your credit card bill that you bought something from somebody you didn't know for $4.73? Somebody's checking your number out. And if you don't catch it, the next time they use your credit card number, it won't be for $4.73. It'll be for $4,730. So be careful. Legitimate companies transact information fees. Anybody here have a Gmail account? Who owns the information that you send on your emails? Google does. Not you. Google does. What happens to the pictures you post on Facebook? Who owns those pictures? Facebook does. And if they want to sell them for commercial purposes, they can. You know the little thing at the beginning when you sign up for those programs, or you scroll to the bottom and hit accept? Read one of them one time. You'd be astonished at what you're giving up by hitting that accept button. They're supposedly free, as my favorite musician Billy Idol said. We think information is free, but it is not. Governments are becoming increasingly control-oriented. So here's some key terms that you're supposed to be familiar with from reading the class, like big data. What's big data? Yeah, it's the big net. It catches all the fish and brings it in. Okay, is that a problem? Not normally. Is how it's used. You can collect all your big data from everybody in your big net and look for bomb making instructions. Type in that and it'll tell you who's doing bomb making instructions. And you, as a upstanding federal law enforcement official, can target those people and track them down before they execute a terrorist attack. Can you also type in G.K. Cunningham, find out everything about me that's been collected in this big net? You sure can. So, megadata may be collected for good purposes, but it has the potential to be used and focused in very illegitimate ways. Encryption, what's encryption? Yeah, it's scrambling of all the information. All those little ones and zeros that make up code, but it can be mixed up in a lot of different ways. And that's encryption. And what it does is if you encrypt it and you send it to somebody else, they de-encrypt it, and nobody in the middle can read what it is, in theory. Now, if you're one of these federal guys trying to stop terrorists from blowing things up, is encryption a good thing? Yeah, not unless you know about it. So what your average FBI agent would tell you is, well, the encryption's fine, but we need a backdoor system so that legitimate law enforcement officials can go in there and find out what's being talked about. The global positioning system, GPS, anybody know what that is? How's it work? Yeah, there's a bunch of satellites up there in geosynchronous orbit. And that's pretty tricky. It's got to be just at the right distance in order to keep rotating around the same spot as the Earth turns. Now, this constellation of satellites enables somebody on the ground to get a fix on two or three points. When those two or three points intersect, you know where you are. That's pretty simple. We have the capability of doing that. We have the capability of putting it into our cell phones. So if you lose your cell phone, all you have to do is turn to your spouse or your son or daughter and say, "Oh, where's my cell phone at?" They can tap in some nice little numbers and bingo, it'll tell you where your cell phone is. I left mine in my office one day. It wasn't quite as accurate as I thought. It had really positioned my cell phone in the Root Hall gym, but that's only about 20 yards away, so it was all right. So that's good. And mom or dad can simply program that in and know where their child is 24 hours a day. Because wherever the kid is, the cell phone is. But so can everybody else, to include law enforcement officials and everybody else. The National Security Agency, what's that? Yeah, Big Brother. You wouldn't have said that. You didn't say that on the 12th of September 2001. But everybody begins to wonder about that now. You know, it used to be called NSA, the National Security Agency, but it was really no such agency. Nobody admitted that it existed. They can do fantastic stuff, absolutely fantastic stuff. It's almost science fiction in its ability to do things. But they really can do it, and they can really do it to you and I. They know. Edward Snowden, that name familiar to anybody? He's associated with NSA, the National Security Agency. Is he a hero or is he a zero? Sure does. Depends on the point of view. Certainly, if you look at it in terms of black and white, he signed a document that said he would not disclose any national secrets. And he disclosed a national secret. Did he disclose a national secret because he's a Russian spy? He is in Russia. Or because he felt a moral obligation to let American citizens know what was going on. Whew. Those are one of those tough psychology decisions, you know. Lesser of two evils, better of two goods. You'll have to work on those. I'm moving on to surveillance. What is surveillance? Monitoring. The United Kingdom is probably the most monitored country on the face of the earth. Every individual citizen has his picture taken some possible number of times, like 30 or 40 every day. They got cameras everywhere. Oh, but doesn't Google have cameras everywhere? Google. They got, you know, want to see a traffic pattern, you dial it into Google, and Google will tell you what the traffic flow is with a camera. We're watched. I got that feeling one time in what city was I in? Famous city, New Orleans. New Orleans, I walked into a casino. And I walked into the casino and I'd never done that. You know, I'm just a, you know, very simple guy. I was born here in Pennsylvania. I'm in New Orleans and I'm looking around in this glitzy place. People are yanking on the handles of machines and they're dealing cards and they're rolling dice. Lots is going on. And I look up at the ceiling and there's all these little blacked out glass bubbles all over the ceiling. And I said, man, look at that. That's a surveillance system. Any place that has that much surveillance system on the ceiling is not the kind of place G.K. Cunningham needs to be, so I left. But it's there. The Electronics Communication Privacy Act, the ECPA. What's that? It was mentioned in the article. Yeah. It's the basic foundational document that we use. Unfortunately, it's about 20 years out of date. It deals with mobile technology at a time when everybody was carrying around Motorola bricks. Nothing to do with cell phones, like we currently know them, and it's certainly not smartphones. So it's very hard to implement, but that's the kind of legislation, that's where the legislation, or the center of the legislation is, the mean, or the median of legislation is right there with the Electronics Communication Privacy Act. And most of us would look at it and say it's inadequate to handle the 21st century problems we have. Cybersecurity, what's that? Very good. Very good. Yeah, I was on WITF's NPR, you know, talking about this issue and the North Korean hacking of Sony. And it was just kind of odd. People would call in and say, you know, how do we know it's the North Koreans? I mean, they got, this is North Korean fingerprints all over it. There's no question. And then they said, well, what's the matter with these people in North Korea? You know, it's a comedy. It's satire. It's irony. It's just a joke. I said, you don't understand. In North Korea, they don't take jokes. They're very serious about it. Cybersecurity is big business. You hear about it all the time. What's the advertisement that goes on NPR every morning? You know, they can't hack what they can't see. Somebody's got a program for that. I better get that. These are all issues. So let's take about a 15-minute break here, and when we're back, we're going to talk about some of these cyber privacy issues.
So we'll start with questions and see how that goes. So who wants to be first?
Thank you. This is the best I've been exposed to in many years on ethics. A group of commanders were invited to Leavenworth for a briefing on ethics some years ago. And towards the end of the presentation, much less than what you presented today, by the way, Chief of Staff was standing in the front row as the officer who was giving the presentation was concluding and asked the chief, do you have any comments? Chief turns towards the class, puts his hand on the desk in front of me, looks above all of us, and he says, don't forget about situational ethics. Does the Army still teach situational ethics?
Only as a concept. Yeah. Okay. Situational ethics are when you shift your field. Now, when we first started talking about ethics, though, we mentioned that ethics had a related topic of integrity. The lady in front of you mentioned very specifically what integrity meant to her. It meant unity. It meant one idea. If you can shift your ethics for every situation, how many ethics do you have? And that is a concept that we have to deal with. However, there are situations which apply. For example, the basic definition of privacy, at least in U.S. law, was written about 1890 by a guy by the name of Brandeis. And he said that privacy is the right to be left alone. Does that make sense? Okay. Well, if you're with a group of three survivors from a shipwreck on a desert island in the South Pacific, and the ship's going by and the captain looks out with his binoculars and sees you and says, you know, those three guys have a right to be left alone, and sails on, does that apply to you? Okay. Yes, situations matter, but they matter in terms of a context, not in terms of what's right or wrong. How you apply it may be very, very different. Okay. And that's part of the process of the ethics of caring, for example. That whole idea that relationships matter. You all, every one of you, because you use the internet, are targeted in old-style mail. You ever notice how, you know, the mail that you get asking you for money for charitable purposes seems to be pretty focused? It's not a scattergun approach. It's focused because Google's selling your information for 25 cents a person. How do you think Google makes its billions? We all think information should be free, but it is not, said Billy Idol. And that's just one of those things. Okay? All that applies. But well, who do you write the check to? Everybody you get an envelope from? Who does that? You can tell us, we're proud of you. Nobody does that. But you write the check for people you have a connection to. I have two sisters with breast cancer. You can bet. When they send me the envelope, I write the check. I have a connection. And that makes a difference. That's not situational ethics in the term you're talking about. You can't just decide that your ethics matter. That's a matter of expediency. And that sort of goes along with ethical egoism. Whatever's right for me is right, devil take the hindmost. And I'm not sure that's particularly something that the Army would talk about right now, when they're talking professionalism and ethics and soldier values. Does that help? That's a good question.
It used to be the ethic or an ethic that everybody took their hats off, or at least gentlemen took their hats off when they came in inside. That has kind of gone away. Nobody cares about that anymore. But instead, we have cell phones that go off in the middle of a lecture, so badly a grievance that New York had to pass a law against it. So could you comment on how ethics change? Yeah, and is there a rational basis for that change?
That's a good question. I'm going to have to come up with a good answer here. So I'm going to rely upon your question of situational ethics, and it becomes a matter of context. Not too long ago, I was invited to a Boy Scout camp, Camp Hidden Valley, where I was talking to a group of older scouts about leadership. And one of the points I made to them was that leadership doesn't just concern leaders. It takes place in a triad or a concept or a system, okay? And that you have the leader. That leader has followers. If you don't have followers, you don't have a leader. You gotta have followers. See? And you also have something to do. You have a task or a mission or an objective. And it's the goal of the leader to get the followers to accomplish the task, objective, or mission. And you need all three of those things to set the context. And the context is the situation in which all that occurs. Ethics is somewhat like that in many different ways, in that it changes, particularly with regard to laws. Okay? Now, I remember as a child watching Superman on TV. Was that George Reeves. I loved Superman. I used to tie a towel around my neck, jump around. I used to terrify my mother. She was afraid I'd jump out the window or something. But I loved Superman. But it occurred to me that every time the bad guys and Superman got in a fight, the bad guys never lost their hats. They stayed on. The reason was nothing having to do with folkways or mores. It had to do with filming, because they would stop and cut the film so often in these low-grade TV shows that they couldn't tell whether the hat was on or not. So they just taped the hat onto people's heads so it wouldn't fall off. And then you didn't have to worry about the hats. Well, so people did wear their hats indoors, at least in Superman. But I never saw a cell phone on Superman. When was the last time Superman used his iPad? George Reed didn't use an iPad. So a lot of these things are new to us, and we have to come up with folk ways and mores to do it. Now, should we shoot every person whose cell phone goes off in a public forum? Sometimes we would like to, but I'd say it's probably excessive, because lots of times it's just plain oversight. It's not anybody's fault. People just forget. Okay. But what happens when a cell phone goes off in a public forum? What happens to the poor person who has the cell phone? Absolutely. All eyes turn on to him. You're the one. I heard your cell phone. It was real bad in church one time. There was a lady sitting up on the pulpit. Her cell phone went off, and she tried to pretend it wasn't there. But that's the kind of social approbation which is going to have to work it. Now, I don't know how that's going to work out as the years go by, because I don't see kids with that same sense that I'm embarrassed. They don't care. I don't blame the child. I blame the parents. But we're going to see it. And it has gotten to the point, and you're starting to see it now, where we go to a place where a forum is like this, and people will start it by saying, please, turn off all your cell phones, just as a reminder to people. Well, that's going to be, I think, the next folkway, which is associated. We're going to have to start doing that, or people won't. Or just learn to ignore them.
I'd be interested in
audience here does concerning this. I do a lot of work online. I think I mentioned that last week. How many here?
Wait a second, Todd.
Yes.
Okay. Here's his question.
And I'll let him moderate this, but I'll put the question out. How many here won't, for example, sign up for a free online course from a well-known university because they have reservations about giving their name and email address to anybody? Or perhaps to some other website, not necessarily a university. How many of you avoid the internet where they ask you for a name and password? I have to look at this. Okay, well, I'm sorry, sir. It's a discussion. Okay. Thank you.
Pair of pants or a shirt or something, and all of a sudden, because I'm a new customer and clearly it kicks up when they run my card, my credit card, that I'm not on their email list. They want my email address. How many people turn them down? Yeah.
The second part to that question is how many people put a false email address?
Yeah. Yeah. He's been putting my email address down. That's why I'm getting all the calls. You know?
Or as a variation, a junk email address, like a false one. I have an email address I use
Bob's
just for that.
Address down all the time.
Yeah. I use my Gmail address. That'll fool them. I'll fool Google, too.
Just an interesting addition to that.
Please wait for the mic there.
I just signed up for a Sheets discount card, and you have to register it. And they have a series of questions they ask you. And it's very interesting. Some of them have a little star that say this is required, and others say this is not required. But their list of questions, there was about 12 of them. The name was required, the email address was required, and then how old are you, what sex are you, all that sort of thing, wasn't marked. And the third check was either male, female, or none of your damn business is the way it was written. Way it was written, none of your damn business. Just check that.
Well, that's good. Okay. But these are issues we'll get at the heart, I think, of what we're talking about when we're talking internet privacy. Because, you know, if you want the service, you pony up the information. Okay? At the bottom of all that stuff at the beginning, when you sign up for these things, there's a little button that says, I accept, and you're supposed to click it. You click that button and you accept all that other stuff. If you click no, you're not getting it. And so what happens is you are taxed or charged an information fee for the service. It's not monetarily, but it's an information fee that you have to pay to get the service. And what I think most people are irritated about, and I think you mentioned this very, very carefully, is that a lot of that's surreptitious. You don't know. What are they doing with the information? Who are they giving it to? And you've all seen it. You want to go ice fishing. Off to Minnesota you go, and you want to make sure your little piggies are warm, so you buy some big sorrel boots with a thick felt liner, so you can stand on the ice and fish and catch a great northern pike. So you check a couple places out just to find out who's got the cheapest sorrel boots. And then every place you go on the internet, along the right-hand side of the road, is an advertisement for sorrel boots. Why does that occur? Pardon? This is little data. This is particularized data.
Talking about big data.
We'll get back.
Then when we say cyberspace, you know, there is a layer that is not public and could be a place where you don't go. Dark data. If you could address that, please.
Yeah. Well, dark data is really a realm of the internet that is not open access. It's particularized. It is given out to the members who frequent that information. When you get your credit card information stolen from Target, and whoever steals it chunks it up, where does he sell it? He sells it in the dark data internet. Just advertises. I got 3 million credit card numbers. I'll sell you 100,000 for 100,000 bucks. Good system, if you're a crook. But that's where that dark data all resides. It's all underneath. And it doesn't occur that, you know, in the visible sense, because if you don't know where to go to find it, it's very difficult to find it. But the people that use it know where it's all at. It's not so much data as it is the network that makes these surreptitious and criminal acts occur. And it's all over. But you mentioned, you know, why is it you get those advertisements for sorrel boots? You mentioned a term, a cookie. What's a cookie? Yeah, it's a little bit of information that identifies your computer. Not necessarily you personally, but it identifies your computer. And as you go in and as you access one of these places, they'll drop these off. One of the classics is called DoubleClick. So go into your system, go into the options, find security, look at cookies, and see if you've got double click on there. Because if you've got double click, every place you go to is reported to Google. And so you go someplace, they know it's you. Not necessarily you personally, but they know it's your computer, and they know that you were looking for boots, so they put the boots down the side. You got a cookie. That's a.
I don't have any connection to the Harrisburg newspaper or Penn Live, the website, but they offer monthly a luncheon, free luncheon, a Panera luncheon brought in, and an hour discussion on various things about the use of the internet today. It's not as deep or comprehensive as his is, but when they take a particular topic, they do a very good presentation. And for example, what Marcia and I have learned there is that when that page you go to, when you say, I'm gonna click on this New York Times article or something else, you'll see the article come up a split second before you see the ads. And that's because the ads are actually going through an auctioning process using algorithms, so that the sorrel boots people at that moment, because you just looked at their website, will bid a little bit higher for somebody who's just been to their website. And so that's why they came up first. But whoever then made the second highest bid comes up second, and you see those ads loading up in that way. Now, I just told you about this monthly free luncheon that they provide. And that is an example of something else that they count on. They might get me digitally and Marcia digitally, but they count on my word of mouth to maybe carry it to someone else. And so just as he taught us that there's thousands of years of history behind the ethical thinking here, there's a lot of other thinking. From the time you got an account at a department store 50 years ago, somebody was collecting information on you. And whatever that department store is still collecting today can be aggregated, merged with what Google's collecting. And so it becomes more than that. And Penn Live will tell you that they have access to data on 480 million persons. It's very fascinating.
All that's keen essential. When you go to Amazon.com, remember, and you buy a book or something, it will show you pictures of books at the bottom. You might be interested in this. That's because Amazon.com puts a cookie on your machine. Now, most of the cookies of that type will turn off. When you drop out of Amazon.com, the cookie goes dormant. When you go back into Amazon.com, the cookie reactivates and says, you know, you like dinosaurs. Here's some dinosaur DVDs you may want to buy. Very, very clever. But why does this happen? It's driven by the market. Driven by the market. No. Sir?
Yeah, about 15 years ago, we had a friend of mine had a discussion about Bill Clinton and his escapades, and nobody seemed to care. I guess what I'm wondering now is, are we creating a new type of person who just doesn't care whether you know all this stuff or not? Is that going to be the new type of person?
The question is, you know, do people really care about cybersecurity? Do they care about privacy? And in a certain sense, the answer is no. Because go back to that concept of big data. Okay? It's a lot of data collected on a lot of people. How does that get focused on any one individual? In most circumstances, it doesn't. You know, the chances of the National Security Agency knocking on your door saying, yeah, we just happen to be surfing the internet and we noticed your name and we'd like to talk to you. That just doesn't happen. Nobody here has ever been contacted by the National Security Agency as a security threat. Because they're not looking for you. They're looking for particular little bumps that appear in the big data, and then they'll focus on that. And most people tend to be happy with that. You know, they're happy with Facebook. You know, I get to put free pictures from Instagram on my Facebook account. I'm not doing dumb things like riding a bicycle down a cliff into a shark-infested lagoon. But they don't see the connectivity outside that realm. And that's where I think privacy issues on the internet are so important, because people aren't seeing the connectivity. It may not matter to the National Security Agency that you're a 14-year-old girl with problems in self-esteem. But I can guarantee there's somebody out there that cares, and he may not be a nice person. And that same data can be used by stalkers, by criminals, by sexual deviants, all sorts of things. You just have to be careful. It's pervasive. And we don't give it the emphasis we need to. We kind of just accept it. That because it's big data, I can be personally identified, but the chances of that are so slim it doesn't matter. It might matter to somebody.
One of the things that bothers me the most about the internet is the anonymity. I think it changes the whole ballgame in terms of the way humans behave. And I just heard on some recent talk show or news show that there's going to be a way for potentially criminals to hide behind their own encryption so that not even law enforcement can get at them, which increases the anonymity even more. I'm not convinced yet that this is a positive gain for the human race right now. I think it's basically a net negative. I'm interested in your thoughts on the hiding from law enforcement.
The question is, the internet offers a certain amount of anonymity. It's not as much as many people think, but it does. You know, you can hide behind it. You can. It used to be called in chat rooms flaming, where you just shoot down somebody in most vulgar and profane terms because you're anonymous. They couldn't get back to you. That's the whole basis of dark data, that level of anonymity that allows things to occur without necessarily being personally identifiable. You can be tracked down. The very same systems that allow the anonymity And a lot of the collection of data will allow you to identify people in very easy ways. You can start by just going to one of the places for phone numbers. It usually gives a name, the phone number, and an address. From there, you can Google the name, come up with more contacts. There's one place, it starts with a Z, I think it's called zam.com, or maybe zap.com, which will tell you sites where you can get more information. And you go to those sites and you can accumulate a lot of information relatively quickly. So there is a lot of anonymity. It's a very fragile anonymity because it can be penetrated, but it allows people to do things that they would not otherwise do. Sort of like going to the Mardi Gras in that fine city, New Orleans, and putting a mask on. Then you get to act like an idiot because nobody knows who you are. You know, the internet can do that digitally for you. And the one picture, let's see, a while back, let me see if I can get it real quick. Oh boy, this is fun. There it is. That represents what we call the digital self. Okay. The digital self is what you make it out to be. And you can create a digital self that has nothing to do with you as an individual, completely different, and have that on the internet as a persona. This is very common in the gaming world among youth. They will establish a persona to play World of Warcraft. And the persona gets powerful skills and weapons of fireballs to throw and giant laser swords and all sorts of things. The problem is, some of them think their persona is really them. And it's very sad. But that goes right along with this idea of anonymity. You can create a person on the internet as a digital self that is not you. The flip side of that is you've got a digital self, whether you believe it or not, and it's accessible to others. If you use the internet, you've established a digital footprint. Good question.
I have a question. Going back to dark data, I understand that there's a lot of information out there that you can Google and get, but I understand that what we get is only like 4-5% of the internet. The rest of it is sort of password protected or whatever. That tells me that there's an awful lot of information out there that's not retrievable by us. I would hope that my government is protecting me from that dark data.
Well, I don't know where the source of the percentage is, but there's an awful lot of that stuff that goes on out there. And some of it's you. When you log into target.com, you put in a password. That sort of protects you. It kind of focuses that information. To log into the National Capital Area Council, the Boy Scouts of America, you have to have a member number. And you have to put that member number in to get access to the databases. That kind of protects it. So there's a lot out there that is, in fact, protected in one way or another. When you start to get into encryption, you can conceal a great deal more. Because it's difficult to break through the encryption. Can the National Security Agency do it? Who knows?
I was just going to say that the interesting use of anonymity is the increase in the use of sick days, since you no longer have to phone and speak to a human to say you're not coming to work. You can just email that you're not coming to work. Therefore, it's much easier to do.
Well, son of a gun, thank you very much.
I've been thinking, listening to you, that so much of the problem with cybersecurity is due to our ignorance. And, you know, I know there's a lot of training going on, obviously, through the armed forces, through schools, universities, but, you know, we don't see anything like come and learn about how to secure your information on the internet. And I'm wondering, that worries me more than anything. I mean, I like Facebook because I like to see my grandchildren's pictures.
Yes,
but
so.
Every so often it'll say, so-and-so wants to be your friend. I never heard of the person. I get a message, thank you for accepting my friendship. And I don't know what I'm doing. I mean, my daughter would know. But I don't know what I'm doing, even though I feel like I'm reasonably literate. Do you have any suggestions for how we can better educate people about protecting themselves?
How can we better educate people by protecting themselves? I would suggest coming to a lecture in the Great Decisions program. That might help. But there are many ways. Don't forget, here we go, I have to go back again. I've got so many good slides, I can't keep track of them all. Look at those four guys, they're great. Okay. Some of the answer is indeed code. That is, there are technical solutions to the problems. You can get encryption. You can buy systems that will help seal off your program by giving you a mini server that puts between your computer and the outside world, so that anything that comes in has to go through that server. And that's where all the junk gets stopped. That's where all the cookies end up. So a lot of your computers are protected in that way. That's a fairly common thing to do. But there are a lot of technical solutions. There are programs that can screen you out, will identify malware before it goes on your computer. What's the issue there? No? You got to pay for it. Okay. The access is free. Screening it out costs money. You got to pay McAfee Corporation to put that stuff in, or malware bytes, or whoever it happens to be. So there are market forces as well as the law, code, norms, and that we have to filter our process and our thought process through. Some of the solution, I think, is technical. We just got to be more sophisticated about it. You can go into your computer, for example, and by clicking on options, security, go into that and set your computer that it will block all third-party cookies, like DoubleClick. It just won't accept them. And it will only accept first-party cookies for the time that you're addressing that person. That's just about every browser has that capability, whether it's Internet Explorer or Firefox or Google Chrome. I don't trust Google. They may have something sneaky. But you can do that. That's a code, a technical solution to the problem. And we've got to get more familiar with those kinds of things. Because the threat is a technical threat. Part of the solution is a technical solution.
Isn't cybersecurity somewhat of an oxymoron? I mean, we have these codes and these security things that we put in, but there are people that can override it. We may not know who they are. Maybe it's the NSA. Maybe it's other people that can get into our computers. And we put things in like codes, and we put things in to, quote, prevent malware, and just as quickly people are figuring ways around that.
That is true. The issue is, you know, is cybersecurity real, or are we just fooling ourselves? Well, I think that some issues are like your lawn. They're like grass. You mow it, it grows. You mow it, it grows. You mow it, it grows. And in a lot of ways, these people who are trying to access your computer are trying to counter cybersecurity programs just as fast as they're produced. So it's a constant update issue. You don't install spyware doctor today and expect it to be able to stop things next year. You have to be periodically, they will come in and update it with the latest to block the stuff. Will we ever catch up? I don't know. It's just like anything else. If you make a law, someone will find a way to counter it.
There's time for one more question.
I just want to offer this for those folks that are concerned. How do I protect myself and the data that I have? One thing that you can do is buy a separate hard drive that you connect to your computer only when you want it connected to your computer. When you, and for those of you who leave your computers on 24/7, okay, your computer is essentially available to just about anybody who wants to get into it if they want to. Having a separate hard drive that you connect only when you want it connected, you can take all your family pictures, everything that you treasure, keep it on that separate hard drive, and disconnect that sucker when you don't want it on the network.
Yeah. Again, that is a technical approach. That is one of the ways we need to approach cyberspace activities. Some of it is going to be technical. It's going to be code. It's going to be hardware. Others are going to be law. We need to have our laws caught up. The ECPA is out of date. It needs to get caught up with what's happening now. Norms, you know, we've got to develop within ourselves as a society a culture which is more focused on privacy and cybersecurity issues if we're ever going to be successful. And finally, you know, the market is going to drive some of this too. If there's a cybersecurity problem, there is someone who will come up with a solution, a better mousetrap that you can purchase to kind of help you. You know what the first step in cybersecurity is? Personal privacy protection on the computer? Turn the thing off. Most people don't do that. You're not using it. Turn it off. That way nobody's planting bots on it while you're sleeping all night. What do they know? They're just techies. They're not ethicists like we are.
I'd like to thank Dr. Cunningham for sharing his wisdom with us today
thank
and giving
you
us
much.
Some other tips on how to protect ourselves with our technology use.
Thank you,
so
Michael.
Please accept this.
Well, thank you very much.